Into a bar fight over a spilled drink. Push comes to shove, he punched the guy in the face. Boom, knocked him out. The guy fell down, banged his head on the stool. He died. Right? So the guy dies. Now, it's not like you could turn around and go, it wasn't me. You did it right in the bar. The bartender saw you, the fucking everybody saw you. Now, I know you didn't mean to kill the guy, but that's involuntary manslaughter in the eyes of what's called the law. Right? So now you have to deal with the law. Does anybody talk about that? What happens if you go under hit fucking hard and the guy dies or ends up with quadriplegic? Well, here's what happens. 6 years, mandatory jail. You spilt his drink, he turned around, he was rude, so you ended his life. I know you didn't mean to, but there's no virtue of moral, legal, or ethical responsibility in teaching people under hit fucking hard and over it. And when the guy fell on the ground, stomped his head 3 times, and then what happens to you? We live in a day and age, there are CCTV cameras everywhere. The minute I go, hey, to you, 12 people are going to pull out their cell phones and start filming the situation.
Yeah.
So in order to understand violence and self-defense, where most people teach it from the perspective of, I'm the good guy, you're the bad guy, if you do this, I do that, that's very limited, myopic, isn't it? Now, if I want to understand self-defense truly, I have to see it from my perspective, the good guy. His perspective now, wait a minute, is he a good guy? Having a bad day? Guy just like me? We're arguing over a parking spot. I'm not right, he's not right, there's no right and wrong, really, we're just disagreeing, right? So we're about to fight over this, aren't we? Lives have been lost over parking spots. One of my students in one of the high schools, he's a 14-year-old boy, his father was 7, when he was 7 years old, he was in the car, he watched his father get stabbed to death in the streets of Toronto over an argument in a road rage situation, yeah?
Jeez.
I mean, so why? Road rage, and people flare. Now, it looks like antisocial violence, but good people having bad days snap under pressure and then regret it later, don't they? Fuck, this ruined my life. I didn't mean to kill a guy. I can't believe I acted this way. Why the fuck was I carrying a knife in the first? There's always regret from people who have empathy. The people who don't regret it, they're the sociopaths. They're the psychopaths. They're the people who, well, they're antisocial. Fuck, you, I'll stab you, and if you want to get out, I'll stab again. Right? So, now, what am I dealing with? Who's in front of my face right now when that guy got out of the car going, hey man, you just fucking took my parking spot. Do I know who he is? Now, as the situation's happening, who's watching it? Is my kid in the car? My wife? Does this guy have his family in the car when this is happening, watching it? Is anybody filming it? How's the prosecution going to view this if this goes to law? What's the defense attorney going to look at it? So all of that plays a role into what's going to happen to me when I deal with a violent confrontation, because there's an aftermath to the situation. I can just punch a guy in the face, he falls down, I break his jaw, he's got a slight concussion, right? And now he's pressing charges. I'm not going to go to jail, right? Maybe a year, but I'll be out in 6 months. Or maybe I don't go to jail at all, but I get a police record. Not just a police record. Right? I have to do forced anger management classes now, apparently, because, well, I still have to pay for my crime, so maybe a house arrest for 2 months with a bracelet, and then I have to pick up garbage on the freeway in an orange suit for the city to pay for my crimes. Because after all, I didn't kill anybody, I just broke his jaw. He happened to be a telecommunicator, marketer, teacher. He needed to talk to work. So it's not just a legal lawsuit. He's suing me now for $150,000, $250,000. I don't have insurance for that. I don't have money to fucking hire a $450 an hour lawyer to fucking battle in court for a year over a broken jaw in a bar fight or a road rage situation, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, and now I have a police record. Try to get a job with a police record. Try to fucking, right? This ruins a person's life, but nobody sees beyond the guys in your face. Hold on a minute. Let's wait, what happened, what led to this? How did we get here? And so, violence is about a lot more than hitting people. It's 90% behavioral, psychological, emotional, and it's rooted, literally rooted in trauma. Like, so, from the good guy having a bad day, all the way to the sadistic serial killer types, and everything in between, violence is rooted in trauma. Now, if I get a bunch of students who come in, and I don't know who they are, if one of the people in my class has been raped or has been, you know, is presently had been going through abuse because, who knows, domestic violence, a woman who, anyone could be going through any kind of hell. If I don't know that and I'm teaching in a certain way, I'm doing them more damage than good because they're going through PTSD every time they fucking come to my class. And then they go home and they try their shit and the shit doesn't work. It's not that the shit failed them. It's that there's the disconnect. If the person suffers from trauma that came from violence before and they never dealt with it, without proper good psychotherapy, there's no amount of self-defense classes in the world that's going to help this person out of the situation, depending on the severity of the trauma, of course, right?
Yes.
So,
absolutely.
In essence, that's what study of violence is. It's we're giving people all of that information, and it's not a system or a style or opinion. It's a scientifically based, if you will, information, not our opinion or moves or techniques, or it's not Senshido or Krav Maga or combatives. It's self-defense human beings. Like, right. Doesn't matter what country you're from, what age, how old you are, what gender, your physical limitations, nothing. This stuff will be applicable to you in one way or another.
Right.
Like we had a 14-year-old girl from Montreal. After taking our first set of classes, which is literally 5 hours, she figured out that she was suffering emotional abuse from both of her parents who were suffering from extreme narcissistic personality disorder. And when she figured that out from our class, she secretly, without telling her parents, went to seek therapy. And through the therapy, the therapist taught her how to literally deal with her parents so she doesn't take it personally and that the emotional abuse doesn't affect her, because now she saw her parents for what they were and understand why they were the way they were. And you can't help anybody who doesn't want to be helped. So it's not like you can go home and go, Mom, you're a socio or you're narcissistic, because they're going to go, fuck you, because they don't understand it. Because these people, they're not doing it on purpose. People who emotionally abuse other people, a lot of the times, they're not even aware they're doing it. For example, if you live with somebody who suffers from road rage, you're in the car with them, child or spouse for that matter, and the driver always road rages whenever you go out of the house together as a family or as a unit. Now, they're not yelling at you, but fuck you, piece of shit, you cocksucker, learn how to drive, you son of a... Who's suffering? Who's hearing all of that? Mm. The two people in the car. That's the fucking guy in the other car. Shit, he's in his car. So at the end of the day, if your loved ones were fucking receiving that on a weekly basis, and if you're doing it in the car, you're doing it at home while watching TV, sports, you're bringing that into every part of your life. Now, you're doing this and you have a family member who's around you who always has to fucking walk on eggshells because I don't know when mom or dad are going to flip out. That's emotional abuse. 10, 12, 15, 18 years of that every single day of your life. You don't realize, but you walk out of there and you've got trauma. Mm. You happen to be worldwide statistics that one out of four people on planet Earth today suffers from one form of mental illness or another. Yeah. I'm one of them. I have PTSD, diagnosed depression, mild social anxiety disorder based on my post-traumatic stress disorder. Right? So I'm diagnosed and I understand my weaknesses and my strengths. I know it. Why am I in therapy? Without therapy, I had no clue. And until I got therapy, which completely altered and changed my life for the better, and therapy is just like self-defense, by the way. It's like, right? There's for every good therapist, there's 1,000 shitty ones. So you kind of have to do your homework, go try out a few until you click with one, and you go, fuck this one, right? So just like that, because I've so many people go to therapy, well, therapy's not for me. Why? Because you went once, you tried it, you didn't like the guy. He looked at his clock every time he was doing it. That's him. That's not therapy. You don't judge fucking an entire science that has saved thousands of people and brought us to where we are today because one asshole is a shitty therapist.
Yeah, true. So basically the fundamentals and the foundation of this violence and trying to understand it, it sort of empowers people to try and to avoid difficult situations like you mentioned before, where they can get in some really messy situations. So it'll help.
Right.
And like you say, it applies to a big range of age group, a big age group. Like you can teach this to kids.
If you're a human being, it's teachable to you because you have the innate sense of protection, right? You're human. And so it's applicable to you if you're human. And it's not specifically targeting a group of humans, right? Because that would be more self-defense. Mm. Like if I have a program that is really good for bouncers, that doesn't necessarily mean that if I teach a group of 14-year-old girls, I can teach them the exact same thing I just taught the bouncers. It's not the same. It's not logical. And so, but I'm really good at teaching bouncers. And I'm really, right? But that's my niche. That's my strength. That's my forte. I have to be able to recognize that. And I have to be sensible and have enough empathy and recognize that, hey, maybe I shouldn't be teaching women. Maybe I shouldn't be teaching children. Maybe I should be focusing my area of expertise towards cops and soldiers and doormen, and because that's, you know, I'm the this guy, right? Now, then there's people who are, you know, hey, there's tons of groups out there who only teach pure and applied self-defense to, you know, schools, like Safe International, the company I work for. My best buddy, actually, Chris Roberts, runs it. He's brilliant. You know, his main clients are high school children, healthcare centers, corporations, right? First Nations. So, and every one of his clients don't go to his classes because they want to. They go to his classes because they have to. The school made me do it. My corporation paid for the course, so I have to do this 2-hour, right? Or it was brought in, right? So it's not like I hold a seminar, Richard Dimitri is coming, and you're like, oh, Richard Dimitri, I like his stuff. I'm going to willingly go in and learn. So it's very different when you have to teach a 14-year-old girl who's sitting there. She fucking doesn't have any interest in what you're saying. But you have to reach her.
Yeah.
It's not like teaching the guy who comes in and he's an instructor in 3 different combative systems already, right? And he just wants a couple of extra tips to enhance his system. You're looking at 2 completely different human beings with 2 completely different needs.
Yeah.
But on a generic level, for violence prevention, it doesn't matter if the 14-year-old girl or the soldier are in the room, both are going to learn something, right, that they did not know before. And it's applicable to any human being, regardless of the title bestowed upon them, the color of their skin, their gender. Self-defense is human. It's not stylistic or methodical or systematic. It's a human thing, and it's not just a physical occurrence. There's a psychological, emotional, and behavioral aspect to it. A huge one, if not 90% of it. Like I was saying, that girl who went and got therapy, and she was able to come home and deal with her parents, it literally changed and saved her life. She didn't throw a single kick or punch. She didn't need her parents in the groin when she got home after she learned my class. She didn't headbutt them, but she was no longer a victim. She learned how to protect herself and prevent the emotional violence that was happening to her, because if she didn't realize that and she didn't take my class, she would have grown up probably just like them. 30 to 77% of children worldwide who are abused, emotional, psychological, doesn't matter, grew up to become abusers themselves. Hmm. It's a cycle. Like everybody says, violence is a cycle. Yeah, there's a cycle. We have to figure out what is the cycle? Where does it begin and how can we end it? How do we outgrow this? Right? Most people are working the band-aid solution, which is learn to hit fucking hard, the physical stuff. You know, they're going to pay a little bit of risk to awareness. Walk with a purpose and avoid a group of large men. And okay, let's go and hit the pads really hard. Now grab me and grab me. Here's a chokehold and it's like, that's great. Right? But it's not going to help me in an antisocial violence situation with a determined predator. It's going to help me if, against Joe Wolf coming out of the car, who is pissed off because I cut him off, sure. It's going to help me with the drunk guy at the bar, sure. It's going to help me with the average social violent, or mediocre level, low-level antisocial violent individual. But you get any level, higher level than that in the violence spectrum, and all of that shit is about as useful as a fucking slingshot in a war. You got the wrong tool.
Yeah.
I mean, so many. I look at self-defense, combatives, and fighting. These are 3 different animals. Most people lump them together into 1 category. They're not. Too many people are signing up for tennis lessons, but they're learning badminton instead, thinking it's tennis.
Yeah.
It's not. It's badminton. There's nothing wrong with badminton, but it's not. Tennis isn't what you're learning. So if you're going to martial arts thinking you're learning self-defense or violence prevention as a totality, or you're going to send your kid to karate because you they're being bullied in school, or Brazilian jiu-jitsu, You know, bullying today isn't, hey, give me your lunch money anymore. Bullying today is happening in your pocket and on your computer when you get home. Bullying today is not one-on-one, it's 20-on-1. I don't care what Brazilian jiu-jitsu expert you are, you're not defending yourself against what is 90% constituted as what bullying is today. Martial arts teach you bully defense against bullies in the 70s and 80s. Give me your lunch money, man. Oh, oh, my God. Now they stabbed the boy. 20, 30 teenagers stabbed the boy to death in front of his mother right outside of school. Bully prevention. What the fucking, what physical shit are you going to teach him? There's nothing.
What you're saying to me is that it's better to rather teach yourself how to avoid violent situations by understanding violence.
Yes. Preempt by avoiding. If avoiding doesn't work, learn how to de-escalate and determine, does this need to go physical or not? A social violent confrontation, because it's social violent in nature, the person who's in front of you mouthing off didn't leave the house that morning looking to pick a fight that night. They have an issue they won't resolve. It's social violence. Mm. Whether you know it or not. For example, if I get in your face in a bar and I look at you and I go, you fucking looking at my girlfriend, man? I could be one of two people right now. I could be a person who's been having a really shitty week or month, very low, insecure because of my present situation. I'm doubting my wife or girlfriend, and we've been having a bit of a, you know, arguments lately at home. And we went out tonight and we're having a couple of drinks and we're trying to talk it out. And I notice that you're looking at her. And because of the state of emotion I'm in, I might get up and get in your face and go, you fucking looking at my girl, man? Because I'm having this shitty week or month. Or I could be a sociopath. You didn't even look at my girl. Maybe I don't even have a girl in the bar. But I'll walk up to you and go, hey, you fucking piece of shit. You looking at my girlfriend? And you're going to be like, what the f-? No. Yeah, you are. I fucking saw you looking at her. Now, the difference between these two people is that the first person has an issue they want resolved. They believe you were looking at her, and they're pissed about it. The other person, no matter what you say, he's looking to hurt you. This guy here specifically chose you as a victim. This guy over here, it's circumstantial. He really believes you were looking at his girl, or you spilled his drink, or you took his parking spot, or whatever it is he believes you did. And now he's in your face about it, angry, using profanity, because he's personally having a shitty week or month. Now, we do this to our own family members. Sometimes we snap at them because we're emotional and it's not their fault. And we're just in that, oh, and we say something and it's like, well, hey, blah, blah. And like, oh, sorry, it's not you. I just, this and this happened. And, you know, it's kind of leaking from there. It's emotions, right? Sometimes it's that. Now, me as a human being, if somebody gets in my face in a bar and they're talking, and they haven't hit me yet. It's not an ambush. He doesn't have a weapon. He's like, you fucking looking at my girlfriend? I have the moral, legal, and ethical responsibility to figure out, is this a good person having a bad day, or is this a bad guy? So, I don't want to provoke this person. If it's a good person having a bad day, 10 out of 10 times, you could de-escalate it, and you will. Why? Because they don't want to fight. They don't realize they're in a funk. You can snap them out of their funk by de-escalating the situation, especially if they have empathy. If they have empathy, you've got them. The bad guy doesn't have empathy. By definition of antisocial behavior, the person with extreme narcissistic personality disorders have limited empathy or selective empathy. Sociopaths have limited to no empathy, or they can rationalize over it. The psychopath has none, zero, zilch, whatsoever. So you've got a category of people who can't empathize, and then you've got a category of people who can. Now somebody's in my face and I don't know which one he is, but if I punch him out and he happens to be a person with empathy and the guy's got a family, he's a dad, and I put somebody's, you know, some six-year-old child's father in the hospital for the next 9 months, me as a human being with empathy, I'm going to feel like shit about that. Not to mention the lawsuit, the guilt, everything. So I don't want to fucking go bashing people just like me. I want to make sure that if I'm going to get physical, the person deserves it. And it's I had no other choice. So what do? I reach for empathy. I talk. I give them a moral, legal, and ethical way out. A guy shoves me, you fucking looking at my girlfriend, bro. I'm going to look at him and go, hey, man, I'm so sorry, brother. I did not mean to be staring at her. I was drifting off into space, 1,000-mile stare. If I was looking in her direction, I apologize. Or you know what, man? I kind of was looking at her. She kind of looks like somebody I used to go to school with 25, 30 years ago. It's uncanny. Sorry if I made any of you feel uncomfortable. Any good person having a bad day, I don't give a fuck who you are. If somebody answers you like that, you're going to look at them and go, well, okay, stop staring. You can't hit them. Yeah. You're not going to continue. Why? Because you can relate. Shit, I've had 1,000-mile stares before. That's reasonable doubt for anybody with any amount of logic, right? Especially the person that's being, hey, man, I'm really sorry. I didn't mean it, right? Now, the bad guy, he doesn't care about that. The bad guy, if I go up to him and go, hey, brother, I'm really sorry, man. I meant nothing by that. I was staring off into space. The sociopath or the narcissistic guy is going to look at me and go, I don't give a shit, man. You've been staring. I'll know. Now I know. Why? Because no matter how bad of a day I'm having, if I think somebody's looking at my girlfriend and they tell me that, hey, it's a case of mistaken identity, I'm not going to look at him and go, I don't give a shit, because I can relate. I go, okay, that makes sense. I'm going to walk away. I have an issue. I want it resolved. You resolved it. I'm satisfied. I'm gone. There's no need to fight. The bad guy, it's not about the girl. He's looking for a fight. So no matter what you say, he's going to bypass it and insist. A powerful question to ask somebody is, hey, man, how can I help you? A good person having a bad day who has an issue is going to stop and tell you how you can help them. Well, fuck, man, you spilled my drink. You scratched my car. You did this. You did that. They'll tell you. The bad guy is going to look at you and go, you're beyond help now, you piece of shit. You know exactly what you did. They're going to reveal themselves to you. Why? Because I'm searching for empathy. You either have it or you don't. If you really have a problem with me and I say, how can I help you? You're going to tell me how, and I'm going to try to rectify it. Well, you scratched my car. Shit, man, I'm sorry. I'm a klutz. I didn't even fucking, where did I scratch it? Show me. And I'll walk over and I'll look and I'll deduct. Oh, bro, look, the scratch is black and my car is red. So I'm really sorry for your car, but it wasn't me. Or if it was me, I'll fucking pay for the damages. What do you want me to tell you? Well, let's figure it out. Yeah. But a good person having a bad day, you'll talk them down. The bad guy, you can't. Why? They don't have an issue. Their reason for being in your face is to victimize you one way or another.
All right. We're talking about social and antisocial violence. What is the difference?
Yeah. Well, like I was saying, in social violence, you're dealing with a good person having a bad day. Mm-hmm. They have an issue. They want it resolved by you. They believe you did something that wrongs them or disrespected them or hurt them or offended them in one way or another, and they're looking for you to say sorry and explain it and fix it for them. You spilled my drink. Sorry, let me buy you a new one. That's all they're looking for. Like if I'm in a bar and I'm having a shitty day and some guy bumps me and spills my drink, there's a good chance I might look at him and go, hey man, watch, like, right? But if I'm a bad guy, a sociopath, now if you're looking at antisocial violence, then you're looking at an individual who has antisocial behavior. Antisocial behavior falls under 8 to 12 different personality types. Most of the general population only recognizes a handful, so those are the ones we touch upon. The narcissist, the Machiavellian type, the sociopath, and the psychopath. Although these are not diagnoses, they're personality types of antisocial disorders, various. 99.9% of the time rooted in trauma, childhood trauma of some sort that went overlooked. Any kind, from abuse to any kind. That's where it's antisocial violence. A person who has chosen somebody as a victim, that's antisocial violence. A person who is in your face because you spilt their drink or dirt their parking spot, that's mostly social violence. But sometimes we don't know which one it's which, because sometimes you can't tell. A person with antisocial violence, like a sociopath or a psychopath, will play the part of a good person having a bad day. Like if I get in your face, like I said, and I go, hey man, you just spilled my fucking drink. Whether you offer me to buy me new drinks or pay for my clothes, I'm still going to pick a fight with you. Because that's why I'm doing it. I don't care about the drink. You might not have even spilled my drink. I might bump into you, spill my own drink, and then get in your face and pick a fight with you. That's antisocial behavior. So, bullies, rapists, people who sexually assault people, emotional abuse, psychological abuse, kidnapping, anywhere where one human being specifically targets another with reason to hurt or personal, whatever it is, that falls under antisocial behavior. That falls under antisocial violence. That's very, very difficult to de-escalate. Not impossible, but generally improbable. Mm. Why? It's hard to talk a rapist from raping you. It's hard to talk a mugger to walk, you know, not to mug you. But I can talk a drunk person out of fighting me if I spilt his drink in a bar.
Yeah.
Like, I'll give you an example. If I'm antisocial violent behavior person, if I'm a sociopath or a psychopath, I'm going to go to a bar on a Friday night looking for somebody to fucking victimize.
Right.
That's why I'm going out. I'm going to pick a fight and I'm fucking, right? And I'm going to pick somebody. If I'm in a bar and I'm just the guy who said, hey, tonight I'm going out with some friends. I've been having a shitty week at work. I keep arguing with my wife. My fucking kids, I need to blow up some steam with the guys. I'm going to go watch the UFC with my bros at the pub. Now I'm at the pub and I've had this shitty week and I'm with my bros. And the guy next to me bumps me and he happens to be cheering the guy that I don't like, right? And I go, hey, you fucking asshole. And we get into a fight. That's social violence. That's not antisocial. Right. That's just me being a fucking asshole. That guy here, he can defuse the situation. Still. Why? Because I didn't come to the bar looking to fight. I came to the bar to blow off some steam with my friends. This guy just happened to bump me, so it's incidental. It's a social setting where violence erupted incidentally. Social violence. I didn't plan it. I didn't go out looking for anybody to hurt. It's not who I am. So if I get into a physical confrontation, it's because I was emotionally fueled and the other person didn't de-escalate me properly. And I snapped and maybe killed him or we got into a fight or even, I don't know, whatever. So that's the difference between the two. In social violence, you're dealing with good people having bad days, just like you and I. In antisocial violence, you're dealing with predators, people who are out to hurt other people for one reason or another. And that falls under thousands of different categories. And that therein lies the difference.